And hello out there, everybody. What's going on? This is Miho from the Too Close to Call podcast series, and this is another edition in our interview series. And for this episode, we bring on a very special guest, a wonderful woman who was kind enough to join us, a Miss Kat Rogers, who, as we find out in this conversation, was almost an Olympic gymnast, and she goes on to become a Dallas Cowboys cheerleader and is currently an actress who has a role in the current Netflix series special that is available to stream wherever you get Netflix. And I am so thankful that Kat took the time to sit down with us, and I am so thankful that you, the listener, took the time to click on this podcast. It's you guys out there that keep us going. It's you guys that keep me motivated and bringing you guys quality content and loving your feedback. Share us with all your friends, and we'll continue to try to bring you what you guys want to hear, and hopefully you enjoy it. But without further ado, let's get into our interview with Miss Kat Rogers.
And we're live.
Yes, we are. Thank you for that introduction. Please continue, please, by all means.
Welcome to the Too Close to Call podcast. Today is Friday, May 17th.
I believe yes.
And we are headed to the Boston Red Sox
game. Yes, we are. That lovely voice you're hearing out there for the first time, for all you guys thinking, that is not Pags. No, it is not. We have a lovely guest joining us this afternoon, a Miss Kat Rogers. She is a fiance of my friend Ryan Presley, and she in her own right is a phenomenal individual. She is a former Dallas Cowboy cheerleader, currently an actress on the show Special on Netflix.
Yep.
And episode 2. Check that out for everybody out there. But I guess first and foremost, Kat, thank you so much for joining us, taking the time out to talk.
Thanks for having me. Thanks for coming to hang out.
Absolutely. But here on this podcast, I don't know if you're familiar, but we like to kind of dive into not the national mainstream questions that everybody asks our guests, whether they're athletes or musicians or what have you. We know the standard 50 to 100 questions that everybody asks. So what I really want to do is kind of bring you on, have you discuss a little bit more kind of your upbringing, how you became Miss Katherine Rogers. I know life gives us a ton of twists and turns. So really, I kind of just want to let the listener know a little bit more about yourself, how you kind of came to be this successful person, since we've realized now that we're all 30 years old, it's hard as hell to be successful out there in life. I guess first and foremost, you are originally from the Houston area?
Yeah, I'm actually from Houston, born and raised.
Okay. What part of the city, in downtown?
Well, I grew up like in the Memorial area.
Okay.
I went to West Side High School.
That's a known high school, right? Is that the one with all the football players?
No, I wouldn't say that. The school I went to opened my freshman year.
Okay.
So I was the first class to go all the way through.
No way.
And our very first, this is for like you sports fans.
Yes.
Our very first football game was in the Astrodome.
Okay.
And we played against Vince Young's team. So we're like so excited. We're like, yes, oh, first ever game. Let's do this. And we got beat 64-0.
Oh, yeah. I could have seen that one coming.
Yeah.
The inaugural game against the future professional doesn't line up well. But did you have any brothers or sisters growing up?
I did. And I still do. I have an older sister named Lindsay. She lives in Austin, but she literally just sold her house the other day, and she's moving to Costa Rica. So that's awesome.
Costa Rica?
Yeah.
That's sidebar.
What's
up with that? What's she going to Costa Rica for?
She like has her own little blog called The Family Fun Tour.
Oh, nice plug.
And yeah, she... Shout out. And she actually is like a minimalist, and she she like travels everywhere with her family. So
that's
like
awesome.
Literally my niece, who is 4 now.
Okay.
She has like been to more countries than a lot of people, which is crazy.
That is crazy.
So she and her newborn and her daughter and husband are all moving to Costa Rica.
Very cool. Well, you mentioned countries, and as I kind of mentioned, with very little structure for the Too Close to Call, we like to bounce around, but you yourself actually just got back from a trip to Mexico.
Yeah.
With the ball club down there. So take me through that. How was that? I know I talked to Ryan a little bit. He had probably less fun than you did, since he couldn't eat certain meats.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. The players, I love, it's so funny because like, well, we went to Puerto Rico last year with the twins.
Yes.
So like we have that to compare this trip to.
Okay.
But Puerto Rico, he loved and had such a good time because we were on the beach, you know.
Sure.
It was beautiful. But I told him I had so much more fun in Mexico.
Yeah.
Because when we went to Puerto Rico, like a lot of the wives were either pregnant or trying to get pregnant. And that's when Zika was like huge.
Yeah. Okay.
So like there weren't that many girls there. But Ryan obviously like loved being on the beach and all that kind of stuff. Well, in Mexico, everyone came.
Excellent.
And even though like the guys, they couldn't like basically eat anything, drink anything, leave the hotel.
Room service only.
You know, right. That's it was crazy. Like, I felt like we were at camp.
Yeah, that's true.
Because
right?
we had like all of our meals together because they had like specially prepared meals
nice.
And everything.
Okay.
But
yeah,
like we couldn't
camp.
Like go anywhere.
Right.
I remember texting the girls like a picture when Ryan and I were shopping at the mall. And they're like, "You left the hotel." I was like, "I did. It's safe out
it's
here."
Okay. I took the main streets. Alive. It was very lit. I'm fine. But
Monterey was a beautiful city and like the views were gorgeous. Everyone was super nice.
Well, that's the crazy part, right? Again, kind of humanizing your life and Ryan's life is everybody as a fan thinks, oh, football game in Mexico or a football game in Europe. Oh, baseball in Puerto Rico, no problem. But, oh, you can't go down this way. It's like,
right. And before,
about?
Like the guy, not to make the guys sound super high maintenance, but the reality of like the guys, if they eat certain of the meats in Mexico, then they could fail their drug test, which would why we could have to be careful with what the guys ate.
But,
right, we'd rather just not have
right.
to go through.
So after that tangent, back on course, I guess you mentioned you had one sister. Was it just the two of you?
Just the two of us.
Okay. How was that growing up as sisters? What's the age difference?
Oh my gosh,
there?
My sister's 3 years older than
I am.
Oh, you're the young
hated
one.
Hated me so much.
Well,
we had
you're
to go
the
to...
parents' favorite.
Yeah, duh. I came around and it was like, Lindsay who?
Yes.
Just kidding. No, I'm kidding. Oh my gosh, I wanted to be her friend so bad. I used to like sit outside of her bedroom and since she wouldn't let me play with her. Like,
okay.
I would write down everything she and her friends would say.
Oh, my gosh.
Because, like, I wanted to be involved.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's amazing. So, I guess, as your dad, myself, being a recent father with a 15-month-year-old daughter. And
congrats. It's so exciting.
Thank you. Thank you.
That.
Yes, yes, yes. Conversation of more to come eventually type of thing. And in my head, I'm already mentally preparing for another girl. Like, all girls, you have to. That way, when the boy comes, it's kind of like, okay, as opposed to being in the doctor's office when they're like, oh, it's a girl, and you give him, like, a long face or something. Doesn't go over well with the missus.
Right.
So, but how did he, I guess, adapt? Was your dad a sports guy growing up? Was he kind of involved with you guys? Did you do sports growing up, or where? Because I know obviously cheerleader, dancer, that side. Did you play at all, or was it mainly just the ballets? And
that's a great question. I actually, like, before I settled on gymnastics and dance, I was the biggest tomboy in the whole entire world.
No way.
Yeah, my hair was like up to, like, above my ears. Like,
well, that was before it was cool too.
Like, I know,
now,
like,
that's
I was like a trendsetter. And I would wear, like, you know, Air Jordans and like jean shorts and like my hair in a ponytail every single day.
That's
I
awesome.
Like the girls hung out on the monkey bars at recess, but I played soccer with the boys.
Ooh.
Yeah. So I was like,
excellent.
I was telling actually one of the wives, Allie Smith, she played basketball in college.
Okay.
I was telling her I was like on an all boys basketball team, but I was obviously a girl and they would like never pass me the ball.
Bastards. So best to her. She's a girl.
They would never pass to me. And like they did one day and I made one goal the
okay.
whole season.
Nice. I like it.
So yeah, I did a lot of sports and my sister who's actually 5'7". She did all the sports that like I wasn't good at, like volleyball and all the stuff.
So was basketball, I guess, your favorite if you had to pick one growing up, or like?
Well, I was a pitcher in softball.
Nice, nice.
And
rock and arm, of course.
Yeah, well, I wasn't bad actually. I did basketball, swim team, like a little bit of tennis. But then I realized, like, I was, like, really good at gymnastics and, like, really naturally flexible.
Yeah,
and, like,
at what point did that kind of occur? Was that, like, a middle school or high school thing? Because I know on the guy side, very much now, even compared to when I was in high school back in, like, 2005, 6, 7, it is, hey, you're good at this sport. You only play this sport.
Yeah.
Like, the world is kind of navigating that.
Totally.
Way. So I guess back then, was it one of those things where – I don't want to say you were forced into that because kind of my world, it really kind of came down to like there was one instance where football, they were like, hey, you're not going to be at spring practice. You're not going to play.
Right.
And I was like, I have baseball. That doesn't make sense. So
yeah, you have to like eventually choose one sport, which is always hard. I think when I realized when I was like getting into middle school around like fifth or sixth grade is when I kind of started to like get crushes on guys and stuff. And so I wasn't so much of a tomboy anymore.
I can't play basketball with him anymore.
I'm like, this isn't going to work. No, but I had these new aspirations of going to the Junior Olympics and like getting, being on the national team.
Okay.
And that's when I was like, okay, if I'm going to be good at this, they wanted me to be at practice every single day.
Right.
And so it just kind of naturally happened where I kind of just like slowly quit everything else and then was like.
Because I know from afar, that's super time committing.
For a while though, like I would, in one rec center, I would go to like, in the summer, I go to swim team practice,
right,
change into my leotard and do gymnastics.
It's amazing.
And then like same rec center as that where I would change and then go to basketball practice, you know? So I was like doing it all for a while there.
Yes.
But yeah, I got really serious about gymnastics.
So you obviously carried that all throughout your high school days, and that is not a high school sanctioned sport.
Right. So I did it outside of school, okay, like club gymnastics.
Is that a travel thing? Like, I know Ryan and I grew up, we went to Colorado, we went to New York, and we're freaking 12 years old. And I'm going, oh my goodness. So something similar
exactly
with you? Or?
It was actually 12 was the age I started to travel like by myself without my mom.
Yeah.
But we would go to Atlanta. I competed in LA.
Get on those airplanes the first
all
time.
Over, yeah. My coach was like my mom at that point because I spent so much time with her, you know?
That's crazy. I guess the pressure side of things too, from parents, maybe not your parents, but obviously myself watching the E Channel, and you see all of those kind of shows with
the younger
people, and whether it's a beauty pageant.
Yeah,
or
the dance moms.
Yes, exactly right.
That's like, so real.
I don't mean to be like rude or anything, but I'm like, is that like a thing?
That's such a thing. And like they would make me nervous because like my mom, she worked. So like she wouldn't have the time to like sit there and like actually watch all my practices. Thank God, because she made me nervous. Yeah, I'm like, Mom, just don't watch. But like a lot of the moms got to sit there and like watch our routines and then like talk to each other. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't like this at all. Because like
crazy.
All of us girls, like we just want to be friends.
Yeah. Is that a team thing or an individual? Or
it's individual.
Both.
It could be both.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you were more on the individual side of things?
Yeah, I did rhythmic gymnastics.
Okay.
Which, like, people love to, you know.
Is that the one, like, old school where he does the thing?
Yes.
And of course, right?
But it's
actually,
like, really hard sport and, like, takes a lot of skill.
So I guess then as a total novice and somebody who's completely ignorant right now, what is the goal there?
Or the purpose?
Even from within the dancing itself, like, the run itself, you're judged on elegance, beauty, rhythm.
Like artistic expression. It's like dance for side of it. And there's like technical. We get like a technical score.
Okay.
Based on how like high our leg is, how long we can hold a balance, how big our leaps are.
Amazing.
All that stuff.
It's amazing.
Yeah. So it's like a mix of like dance and like gymnastics put together.
Okay. So you mentioned this was like an Olympic style of kind of goal for yourself. So is this not something that you can pursue in college? Was that a decision for you to make, whether you go to school or you go do dance? Or how did that time kind of come about within your high school years?
Yeah, exactly. So I was actually, I ended up being on the national team when I was like in high school.
No way.
So that was like my goal, was
That's
to
awesome.
Be on the US team, which is like,
that's what, one of like 10?
Yeah. So like I had to like
very cool
move to like Placid, New York. I lived at the Olympic Training Center.
No way.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, pause. Let's talk about that because that's awesome, and I didn't know that. So
yeah.
Just you, no family, kind of on
no,
your own.
No, I had to go when I was like 15 years old.
Wow.
It was so scary. We worked out like 10 hours a day.
Jeez.
My coach was Bulgarian, and so like you know she was running the show like
no
totally different than my American coach at home.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Okay, and that's you train for every 2 years or four?
Rhythmic gymnastics is also like a team sport, and there's individual and then there's group.
Okay.
So I was selected to be on the group team, which is five girls doing like a synchronized routine
Very
together.
Cool. Gotcha.
So I had to move this particular year because obviously rhythmic gymnastics is not popular in the US. It's
sure.
like a European sport.
Okay.
So that particular year was 2002. The USA was hosting world championships.
Nice.
Which is why they like decided to like put a lot more, I guess, money and training into our team.
Right. Got to show out for the home squad, right?
Exactly. Like, so they had us all move to the training center, which they don't normally do. Usually they just like.
Oh, interesting. So how long was that? A summer?
I moved there in January, and then Worlds was in July.
So what did you do spring semester of school?
So I was in homeroom when they called me. It was a Wednesday, and they're like, we need you to come, like, Friday.
Okay.
So I'm, like, in the airport calling my friends, like, I'm moving to New York.
Oh, my
and
God.
When I got there, I enrolled into Lake Placid High School. I would take the bus with the girls to school, and then they would let us out. Our team, they would let us leave at 1 o'clock.
Gotcha.
We would take a taxi home,
oh my
and then
God.
We would we'd eat together and then train from, like, 1:30 until, like,
That's
9
so
or
wild.
10 at night.
Oh my God. And you are 15 at this point? Like, can't even drive and.
Can't even. I got my
out
license
on your own.
While I was in Lake Placid. And I was like,
did you have
wah.
A New York license?
No, I wasn't even allowed to, like, drive or anything.
Well, Texas is funky with that. They do, like, the permit a full year ahead of time, or at least when I was living there X number of years ago. There were 15 year olds driving all around in cars.
It's crazy.
Like, up here
at 16, you get it. Then you get 6 months until you get your license. Down there, they were like, nah, 15's cool.
Whatever.
And then right at 16, you're good to go.
Right?
I was like, oh, my God. So, So how did that work out? Did you guys place? Did it?
So we competed, like, we competed in Bulgaria first, like a Grand Prix. It was a Grand Prix that we did in Bulgaria.
Okay.
We did really well for the U.S. We placed second in one of our
that
events.
That is really well.
Which is crazy. We never, like, we beat the Belarusians, which is crazy.
Yeah.
And then when it came to the World Championships, we did, like, a perfect routine, and we ended up getting, like, 12th. And the judges screwed us.
The Russian judge again?
Yes, they screwed us. So like some of the judges got actually suspended after that.
No way.
They were like,
it was like a real
cheating
thing.
Yeah. So after all that,
with high school girls, even, right? Like crazy.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. So you did that for that year, and then after
that, I was like, that was when I was a sophomore in high school, and we wanted to move back to the training center and move to the Olympics.
Right.
But like our team was like emotionally screwed,
yeah,
like drained. Everyone was injured. We had put everything into worlds,
right.
So I went back to competing individually and like went to nationals. Did all that stuff until high school.
So where the hell did you graduate from high school?
I graduated from back to Westside.
Okay,
graduated from there. But back to your original question, which totally took me on the tangent.
No, I love it. That was fantastic. That was awesome.
There are no rhythmic gymnastics teams in college, obviously.
Yes,
and so
yes.
That's when I just like went.
But there are gymnastics teams. I've seen that on ESPN.
Teams, yeah.
And
oh, yeah. And like UCLA has a great gymnastics team.
Yeah, that's exactly actually what I was thinking. I don't know for
yeah.
whatever reason.
Because they're the best. They win all the NCAAs.
Oh,
that's
they're on
why.
Again. And I think that's where that girl got, the perfect 10 out of 10 or something. I saw the floor routine.
Probably.
She had like a crazy score. It was like the top score ever or something. It made it onto like Sports Center, and that's when you know.
That's when you know they're killing it.
Right.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, okay, props for them. But all right, so you're back to where you originally attended high school to finish up.
I finished up, and then I got a dance scholarship.
Okay.
Because that's what rhythmic gymnastics is so much dance. So I'm just like, well, I'll just go get a dance scholarship.
I mean, I'm good at that, so I'll good at this. I'll just go do that. But okay, so what school was that?
So I went to Chapman University. I was like, dead set on going to California school.
California school?
Yeah.
Really?
I applied to all California schools.
No ties to California at all.
I just
saw it on TV, watched 90210.
I went to like a competition there, and I was like, I'm going to live here one day.
Nice. So what part of California is that?
It was in Orange County.
Okay, yeah.
That's when the OC was like huge. So maybe that has something to do with my decision.
Time. That's amazing. I love it. But obviously, we didn't tease it in the beginning. We teased it off air. But fortunately enough for us at Too Close to Call, I'm going to be able to speak with Kat a couple of different times up when she's in the Northeast. So we're going to split this conversation kind of up into three little segments. The first one kind of being the upbringing we spoke about. The second one, we're going to run through college and we could do college now, and then we'll leave to once she becomes a professional into the next one, since I'm looking at the time here and we have a couple more minutes that we'll spare. But so I guess take me through your college experience, and more so kind of the latter end when you're realizing that college doesn't last forever and you may have to go work in an office like some of us, this guy, from 9 to 5.
Yeah, how did that... to avoid that as long as possible.
Right, right. So how does that happen in the dance world? Because us, you know, baseball, you kind of go to the tryouts, you have either get drafted or you're independent, you kind of have that avenue. So is there, I guess, a professional dance avenue? I'm assuming there's like the Broadways or the theater style you can kind of try to get into.
Yeah, I mean, I always had dreams of, you know, I wanted to be either a professional dancer or actress. To NCAA.
Was this after you got to California in Orange County? That's when you realized you wanted to be an actress? Or was that like stemming
from?
That
was when I was little. When I was little, I always did I did some theater, and I loved it so much, and then gymnastics took over.
Sure.
But I actually,
in like a coincidental way, I'm the coach, the UCLA gymnastics coach, Valerie.
Okay.
Coach Val, she was a choreographer also for
SeaWorld San Diego.
Ooh.
There was a summer show called Riptide.
I like
and
it.
So I actually got a job working at SeaWorld like even before I graduated high school.
Okay. You were up there with the whales and stuff?
That's what everyone says. And I always have to disappoint people and say, no, I did not get to swim with the sharks.
Oh, gosh.
My show is on land.
That was me being an asshole, but hey, apparently everybody has
apparently
that remark.
Everyone's an asshole.
I'm sorry.
I wish. I would like literally go watch Shamu like between performances.
Like, go, jump.
I know. Yeah, it was like always a good day.
Okay.
But that was like my favorite job in the entire world. Like, I wish I could still do that today, honestly.
Yeah.
The summer I graduated high school, up until the summer after
college,
okay,
I would move to San Diego.
Really?
And do the show at SeaWorld.
And live there
and
for
live
the summer.
There with like the cast. And like we had like go to the beach all day.
Making money at this point for
making
that?
Making good money.
That's awesome.
Like I was making a living.
Like a dumb amount of money to be dancing at SeaWorld.
Yes. I mean, seriously, it was a dream job.
Oh, that's awesome.
I know. So I would do that every night and then go back to school. So after I graduated college, I moved back to San Diego. Did
right.
SeaWorld as long as I could.
I was going to ask if you ended up coming back home or if you stayed out there for
well, my
a second
was
or two.
Stay out there forever.
Ooh.
But that, dun, dun, dun.
Dun, dun, dun. They call that a cliffhanger for all you listening out there. But yeah, absolutely. Like I mentioned, Catherine's been gracious enough with her time to come on, kind of talk about it. We're going to continue this conversation next month and then as well again into the summer where we'll get into, which I'm sure you Philadelphia fans are looking forward to, learning about the life of a Dallas Cowboys cheerleader and how that whole process kind of goes about working and whatnot. Because again, Catherine, I will say, you know, I was talking to my dad and I was like, yeah, you know, Brian's dating this girl. She was a Cowboys cheerleader. He goes, Kev, there's NFL cheerleaders. And then there's Cowboy cheerleaders.
I love your dad.
So like, I was like, okay, I understand. This is kind of a big deal. She goes, if you could get her on the show, that's kind of a big deal. I was like, all right. Well, thank you so much for, you know, sharing your stories and talking about gymnastics and going to Lake Placid and all that stuff. That's pretty freaking insane for a little 15-year-old girl. And no way.
Yeah.
What'd you do?
I'll tell you about that. Well, whenever I had a little stint in AAA 2 years ago.
Yes.
I was like,
oh, it's not too far.
I know.
Right. Oh, so now I'm putting it together.
Yeah, this is all crazy. So like we were in Rochester and I'm like, we had an off day and it was like the big deal. Like, what is everyone going to do on the off day? And I'm like, we're way too close to Lake Placid to not go.
Sure.
And I took him and he fell in love. He loved
it. It's a nice place, right?
Lake Placid, yes. Sorry.
That's very cool. And that was what, a couple years ago you went back? Was it similar as to what you remembered? Yeah.
Hasn't changed a bit.
Yeah, it's funny how like you get into a city such as Boston or something like this and you come back even 6 months later from when we were here last October and it's like, oh, that's new. Oh, that building. Oh, they're working on that. And then you get into kind of the old place like Placid where it's like, don't touch anything.
Right. It's magical. This is magic. Perfect.
Oh, my
don't
goodness. But as always, we appreciate it. We appreciate you guys listening. Like I said, we're going to have her on the pod again. So if you guys haven't watched Special on Netflix, please do so. She will be out there in episode 2. We will get into that in episode 3 of our conversation because there's a few names and cool stories there, such as Jim Parsons that we're going to ask about and whatnot. So a lot of cool stories to come and a lot of cool stories already been told. So thank you one more time. I appreciate it.
Thank you. That was fun.
Absolutely. And we will talk to you guys soon out there on Too Close to Call. Follow us on social media. Again, being a newbie, I realize this is how you're supposed to close now as I'm stumbling into it, but where do the people find you out there, Kat, when they're trying to follow?
So glad you asked. I'm at Kat Rogers. That's KatKatRogers.
One cat was already taken.
One cat was taken.
That's amazing.
On Twitter
and
Instagram.
You have the blue check, so you should
I don't have the blue check.
Why not?
I don't know.
Okay, so.
I don't know how to get it. If anyone knows, tell me.
Yes, because we were going to get into that too. For you Instagram influencers out there, we're getting that. A lot of great conversations to be had. But if you work for Instagram, get Kat a blue check.
Yes, thank
stat.
You.
So,
like that.
Awesome. Thanks again, Kat. All right. That phenomenal interview with Kat Rogers was brought to you by The Ram King, The T-Shirt King. Visit www.theramking.com for all your T-shirt needs. If you're looking to put together an order to support a cause, or if you need something for an elementary school field day or anything where there's 30, 50 shirts involved, The Ram King's your guy. Visit www.theramking.com. Type in the Too Close to Call podcast where you heard about him. Get yourself the friends and families discount and impress all your friends with some high quality t-shirts for the event that you need. But as always, guys, I appreciate you listening. This was Miho. That was Kat Rogers at KATKAT Rogers. Give her a follow. Let her know how much you loved her interview. Thank her for coming on the show for us. And as always, we will talk to you guys very soon. Peace.